Today we turn to the Gospel of John, chapter 20, verses 19 through 31. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being shut where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the print of the nails, and place my fingers in the mark of the nails, and place my hand in his side, I will not believe." 8 days later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. The doors were shut, but Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not be faithless, but believing." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the reading of the word. Thanks be to God. I like vacation. Who doesn't? I noticed some. A vacation in which you are painting and caulking and nailing and retaping and repainting and touching up and tearing down doesn't sound like much of a vacation, right? You all didn't want to do that last week? Because for me, it was awesome. I had no phone calls, no emails, nowhere I was expected to be. It was wonderful. I could get done what I needed to get done. Kind of, I admit it, not quite there. But it also renewed in me a sense of purpose. It was really hard to keep my laptop shut all week long. I admit, I might have written down a couple of things here or there, you know, ideas. I know all of you are terrified of it when I have an idea. But time away often renews our purpose, right? If you are in a position of which you are meant to be called, and if you are doing something that fulfills you both body, mind, and soul, then time away gives you a little bit of a break, but when you start again, you are like, "Here I am, let's go," right? Or at least I hope you are. I recognize that not all of us are able to be in positions like that. Sometimes we just, kind of like Thomas, are doing what we need to do to get by, right? Because Thomas is the literalist. I love him. Of the disciples, he's the one that's like, "Wait a second. Hold on. I know that Jesus said he would come back from the grave, but are you sure that this is not just somebody telling us that it's Jesus? I mean, a lookalike, A doppelganger. I want to see it. I want to touch his hand. I want to touch his side. I'm not going to believe it until I see it. How many of us are like that? It's an adult reality, right? Life has taught us the lesson that if we do not see it in action, it is not so. Am I wrong? I don't typically think I am, but then again. You see, we are like the disciples in a lot of ways. You see, Thomas had the benefit of seeing Christ, of knowing when he saw Christ that his purpose to go therefore and make more disciples was true. It's always fun to hear about graduation, right? If you're not aware, CWF has a wonderful luncheon planned on, what, May 21st? For our graduates. Some are from preschool into kindergarten. That's a big one. There's another who's moving from elementary school to junior high. That's another milestone in life. And then a couple of the young women in our church who have served in various capacities over the last several years are graduating from college. And when you ask them what they are doing with the rest of their lives, a lot of times you get the answer, I don't know. It's really hard to define our purpose in life. Our purpose, sometimes we feel, I think we all feel this way, that you want to have it all neatly wrapped up and packaged and tied with a nice bow on top so it all makes sense. You want all of our ducks to follow in a row. How many people have ducks that follow in a row? Because I don't know about you all, but mine are milling around the pond. Our purpose, though, in life can be a variety of things. Our purpose as people of God, as Christians, as people who want to call ourselves Christians, though, is a little bit more direct. We're fortunate in that. Christ tells us, blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. As the Father has sent me, even so I send you. All of this is written so that you may believe. These are the words of Christ to us. Now I cherry-picked a little bit. But sometimes you have to read the direction so you can know where you're headed. Don't we feel more fulfilled when we have purpose? There's an old story, I probably told it to you all before because I love this story. But it's a story of a professor of psychology who his students one day asked him, what is the meaning of life, right? And he pulls out an old mirror. And he tells the story of how when he was a child, he came across some broken headlamp, rear view mirror, there we go, and like carved it into this nice round shape, and he spent the time of his life, you know, using it to reflect light, right? reflect the light. Obviously a metaphor. What is the light? Okay, Sunday school answer. What is the light? Wow, Jesus. Okay, maybe we need some worship and wonder up here. What is the light?
Jesus.
There we go. So we are to reflect the light. And our purpose, the meaning in light, is to reflect the light. It then begs of us the question, how? Right? If our purpose is to reflect the light of Christ, if our purpose is to say, I believe, and then to go and share that, those are all really good, big ideas. But we're kind of like Thomas. We're a little bit more practical minded. We like our list of how-to directional steps. Right? I hate IKEA because those things do not make sense. Their directions, you get them. It's pictures. And there are never enough screws for the number of holes. I am super impressed that Chad and I got built-ins built at all. We don't have a clear set of directions because we don't come with an instruction book. Whoever can make an instruction book for babies that actually is valid will make a fortune. They try. But we don't come with instructions. We don't come with a manual, per se. The only manual we have as people of God is a book. And even that's left up to interpretation. But Christ lays it out there for us. He doesn't give us a lot of direction. He just says, believe, and then share what you believe. And we struggle with how to do that. Because we know that people want to be Thomas. They want us to prove it, right? And how can you prove something that's somewhat unprovable? I mean, how can we say we know God? How can we say that we've been filled with the Holy Spirit and that we're walking in the way? How can we say Jesus is my Savior? He came for me. Because the world is like Thomas. They say, hey, wait, I want to see the nails in his hand. I want him right here in front of me. Isn't that what we get all the time? Or maybe I just get it because I'm a minister and people come to me with those questions. And as I thought about this, as I dwelled on this, as I thought about, wait a second. From Easter sunrise, when the message was that the body was not stolen, it instead had been raised from the dead, to Easter morning when we talk about our habits of holiness taking us one step further, to today where we define our purpose as people of God, and we say our purpose is to and the thing is here, I'm not able to answer that. I can't answer that question for you. No one can answer that question for you but you. You see, we as the people of faith are called to study the Word of God. To hear sermons, good, bad, or indifferent. Sorry. with others, to walk with others. Christ did not do this journey alone. He had the 12 and then the others. They met together. They held each other accountable. So our purpose as people of God is to go and share the good news in the way that we know we can. I can't answer how, sorry, unless you really want to come and meet with me every single week and I can lay out, you know, the 1200 step program, A, B, C, and D, because you know I'd lay it out like that. My to-do list is a mile long. We can't let Easter be regulated to one day of the year. We can't say, oh, it happened so long ago. We must live it out today. Because we are the people who believe and who have not seen. That. Maybe just that knowledge in itself is what calls us to our purpose.